Chapter 19. The Comic Side of Recreation. After work, play. I suppose I'm as fond of recreation as anyone else, but some of my favourite recreations have had their comic side. For many years past, my chief hobby has been motoring, and I was the first pro to do my provincial touring on a car. Many's the time I've jumped into my car to keep an engagement at Nottingham or even further away, and I've done many provincial tours on the car all the time. This sort of thing is all very well in these days, when motor cars are such reliable things that one can reckon on arriving as punctually as a train, more so than the trains on some lines, and much quicker. Which reminds me of the story of the lady who was travelling on the South Eastern. She leant out of the carriage window at London Bridge in order to kiss her young man who was seeing her off just as the train started, but missed him and found herself kissing a bearded porter on the platform at New Cross, which was the next stopping place. My word, what speed! The girl, I mean the train, was too fast. But motor cars were not so reliable when they first came out, and I got landed more than once. The great difficulty was getting them up the hills. I remember one trip in particular where they were very trying. It was from Nottingham to Swansea. Hills, hills, hills. There seemed to be nothing but hills. We got sick of having to walk up them, and sicker still when we had to push the car up them. It is a good long push from Nottingham to Swansea, too. At last, when we were nearly there, we came to a final stretch of road with an enormous hill in the distance. I thought I knew something about hills by that time, but from all appearances, this one took the homemade currant bun. It rose like some gigantic mountain and appeared absolutely unclimbable. We were so done that we just sat down by the roadside and cried. But when we'd wiped our eyes and looked up again, the hill had disappeared. It was a cloud. Having vowed 2 candles to the shrine of the first saint we met, we then went on. But I haven't met any saints since, so the vow is still unfulfilled. Correspondence requiring candles, please enclose stamps to cover postage. Another great hobby of mine is fishing. I've had some very good days in the Thames and elsewhere, and I've had some very bad days. I don't mean that I am a very expert angler, versed in every point of the game, but I am very fond of it, and I know enough about it to catch fish, sometimes, and to conform to all the rules of the game, such as always losing the biggest fish and being short of bait on the only day for months when the fish are on the feed, and so on. I once had a day's fishing with Mr. Wall Pink, the well-known songwriter. We were out with rod and line to snare some hundredweights of immense fish from a mighty river famed for its scaly denizens. We fished all day, but like the fellows in the good book, we caught nothing. Wending our weary way homewards, we crossed a bridge over a tiny rivulet which ran through the village where we were staying, and leaning for a moment on the rail, Pink dropped his line in and caught a fish. It was about 2 inches long, but it was really a fish, and we cursed ourselves for having tramped 4 miles to the river on a hot day when we could get such fine sport near home. I had a fishing experience in Scotland about 2 years ago, which I shall never forget. I was on a little holiday jaunt, seeing sights and exploring, and I was strongly recommended to pay a visit to a certain small town, which I was assured was most interesting and where there was said to be some splendid fishing. It was in the winter time, and I arrived at my destination by trap on a bitterly cold day to find a small Scotch town with one pub and not a soul in the street except a marble man on a statue covered with snow. It didn't seem very interesting, so I went into the pub to ask questions. There was one Scotchman and the landlord in the bar, and both of them responded to my merry smile and bright good day in the most effusive way. They did not open their lips, but merely looked into their glasses. I asked them about the fishing, and they informed me grudgingly that it was the wrong time of year and there were no boats to be had and no bait to be got anywhere. After 10 minutes of this, I got a bit sick and walked outside accompanied by the landlord, who seemed to think I'd come to steal something and was anxious to see me safely off the premises. I again asked him if it was not possible to obtain a boat, bait and guidance, but he only shook his head dolefully and said, "Nay." This made me so cross that I put my hand into my breeches pocket and, jingling some coins, said, "Good Lord, man, can't I buy a boat? I want to pay for what I have. Is there no one in the place who has the energy to earn an honest penny for once in his life?" Bless my soul, I nearly fainted. At the jingle of coins and the sound of the word money, the street seemed to vomit men at me. Two rushed out of the pub, which I had left empty. Four or five more ran round from behind the stable door. Several seemed to issue from the statue, and the very marble figure on top stirred in its place and seemed to advance 1 foot as though about to descend. In 5 minutes, I was the centre of a dense crowd of canny Scotchmen, all anxious to serve me.
"Oh, aye," said one. "MacDonald have been having a boat handy, I'm thinking." "Mon," said another, "MacPherson has some grand worms the morn." "I can conduct you to some braw waters, laird," said a third.
In fact, all of them seemed only to have been born in order to render me service. Finally, a boat was procured, and Mac somebody or other came along as gilly with some of the braw worms, a few poor half-frozen carcasses. Embarked upon a large lake, we tried at several places without seeing any signs of fish till I began to get cold, in spite of much swinging of arms and blowing of hands. So I suggested that my gilly should row the boat about while I put on a spinning bait to have a try for a jack. McWhat's-his-name, raising no objection, rowed me about for 2 hours, after which I came in, had a drink at the pub, and commenced to settle up with the various people who had assisted. When I had paid my gilly, I asked him whether people often fished there. He said yes, strangers often fished there, but never caught anything, because there were no fish, except a little thing called a vendace, which is like a sardine with a curious red mark on its head, and which is only found in Sweden, a few English lakes, and this particular piece of water in Scotland. Even these could not be caught with a rod and line, but were sometimes netted in order that they might be bottled in spirits as curiosities. When I had squared up, as I thought, all round, I started off for the trap, but was stayed by a hail from a red-whiskered individual to whom I had seen no reason to weigh out. Says he,
"I'm the MacPherson."
"Oh, are you?" says I. "And what can I do for you, Mr. MacPherson?"
"They were grand worms that MacTavish got for ye frae my back garden this morn. Maybe you'll be wanting some air," says he,
and he half held out his hand insinuatingly. "If your worms were as red as your whiskers," says I might have caught a fish, Mr. MacPherson, but here's a bawbee for you to get some hair dye." Money is a wonderful thing. Of course, there are many other kinds of recreation that have their comic side. I don't care for racing much, but I do occasionally go to race meetings if I happen to be near one at the same time as my friend Hawkeye. Hawkeye is no end of a judge of form, and under his able guidance, racing is about the best and quickest way of dropping money I have ever struck. We once backed every winner right down the card till the last one, and I have no doubt we should have backed that too, if we'd had any money left. But all good things must have an end, and the time has come to bring this book to a close. I will not say many words in conclusion, in case no one might get so far to read them. In 20 years' time, I intend, unless I am then amusing audiences in another world, to write a sequel to this for my present reader's kids to read. I only hope that during the time to come, the public will be as kind to me as it has been in the past, and that a few half hours of amusement and interest may be afforded by the autobiography of this eccentric comedian.